out there in. Ooh, looky here, looky here. They're gonna beat me. They're gonna beat me. Look at this. Oh, they're gonna win. They're ahead of me. Yeah, I like the sheen. Ah, Big Red. Bob's in the house. Sometimes in a man's life. Hey Mark, how you doing? You up in Sioux Falls? Sioux Falls is a fine place. It's a fine place.
You know what?
I know what it is, but man, there it is. Oh, the dust and debris all over things. Smooth, how you doing? Yeah, it'd be afternoon here too. Just barely. Just barely. Yeah. I get some dust off and some more gets on there. Constantly cleaning in here. Get tired of this shit. Oof. Oof. Man. Well. My clock just clicked over, so I have driving hours. I ain't going nowhere. Why ain't you going somewhere, James? Well, I will tell you. last night, picked up what I thought was going to be lawnmowers. Apparently, MTD makes other things besides lawnmowers. I don't know. There might be some lawnmowers up front. I didn't really look at the packing list, the load list. But at the back, there was a buttload of tillers. Tillers. Yeah. Tillers. So, you know, I need to get this leg up a little bit here. There we go. I would say it's just over, just past the halfway point on the truck. Yeah. Yeah, there ain't a whole lot in there. And it ended up being 18,900 pounds, just shy of 19,000. So I like that. Everybody likes that. So I loaded it up, and I didn't have to, because they airbagged it, and it was a pretty good load, but I went ahead and put a couple straps across there. There's a couple of tillers that are up there. They're not really vicarious. They're far enough forward that they probably wouldn't vibrate back or anything. Hey Goldie, how you doing? But I just wanted a little safety strap across there. The dude what load me, he called up, and he was asking if I had another load that was going to come in behind it. No, I didn't, Jerry. No, I didn't touch any Walmart dedicated while I was at Warren. I had my fill of Walmart dedicated at U.S. Express. I had no interest in in a Walmart dedicated. I told the old boy, no, this is it. It's a one-way trip. One pick, one stop. And it's like, yay. And he told me about them two boxes. When I climbed up in there, I just went ahead and I took my straps back there. I put a strap up high and a strap at the top of the top line of boxes coming across. We boogied. They're not touching anything. They're just kind of like safety straps. Kind of looks good in a way. You know. When you get to your customer and they open up the bag, they see these nice, pretty blue straps going across there. It's like, yeah, this guy cares. He's not fat and lazy, and he cares. Even though I'm kind of fat and kind of lazy, it still looks like I care. That's a win. There you go, Smooth, your first golden nugget for the day. There might be another one here. I might just get you another. Perception is reality. They open up the back door and back up there, and they see a bunch of straps on. You're trying, even if you do something stupid and fuck her up some product, at least you try. Perception is reality. You were trying. It's better to have tried and failed than to not have tried at all. Always put some straps on. Under the COVID conditions existing, I'm gonna go out there on the limb real quick. I'm gonna say this COVID thing, even though it's been a pain in the ass for a lot of people, and my heart goes out to anybody who has you know, been under any stress or strain because of it. My heart goes out to anybody who has lost money or a business or something because of it. But it's made my job a hell of a lot easier. It really has. Things that would probably never have changed, things that shippers and receivers would never have done in the past, they would never change. Changed overnight, and for the better for the truck driver. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. You get there and you know, there's, you park over here and you walk up there and you do this and you do that. There's a whole lot of phone conversation now. Prevents a whole lot of that walking. Increases your time on the road because it decreases your time there. They're willing to just take the seal and the paperwork, just chunk it in the back, give you a phone call and say, okay, you're loaded, see you later. You just pull up, close your door, seal it up yourself, put your lock on there. It's another gold nugget for the day. Always lock your trailer. Always. I don't mean always after you just got through loading. I said always. That lock should never, ever, ever leave the back of the trailer. It should never come up here. Ever. Put that lock on. When you open them doors, take the lock off, put the lock right there, open them doors, unload, close your doors, lock it again. Always keep your trailer locked. Always keep your trailer locked. Always, 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 always keep your trailer locked. That's the best advice I can give anybody. At Walmart, they actually required it. When you got the trailer and whatnot, put your little lock on. They required us to have our own lock, and we went and did our thing, and then after the last load, when we're empty, we had to lock the trailer, take it back to Walmart, and then had to get out and unlock that dude and open it up, show them that there wasn't shit in there. We're coming back empty. Kind of confuses me, but I guess in the grand scheme of things, you didn't bring anything back to the DC. There's not a skid left in there or something like that, and they can guarantee that. So I guess that's a good thing. But you always lock the trailer. Always, always, always lock the trailer. Trailers always stay locked, no matter what. And this COVID thing kicked things into high gear as far as getting there. People don't want to get near you. They'll talk to you on the phone, which is good for me because I'm not a very good looking dude, but on the phone I sound like Rico Suave, which puts it in their mind that I just might be Rico Suave. Hey, is a good looking truck driver out there, man. Yeah. Do anything in the world for you. I have fun with them gals on the phone. Makes my day, makes their day. Everybody has a great day. I parked the truck. Did the little live video and everything like that. Got loaded, pulled forward, slid the tandems all the way forward. Fuck it. Sealed it, you know, strapped it, sealed it, locked it, got on the way. And that's when I got to thinking, am I gonna drive this all the way through, which a little over 400 miles, you know, am I gonna drive this all the way through? Because there ain't a whole lot of parking over there around Mount Vernon. There's Mount Pleasant, Mount Vernon, and Sulphur Springs is past that. Am I going to try to find a place to park around Mount Vernon? And then it occurred to me. I've tried before. That didn't happen. And I was going to have to be there a while, not just my 10 hours down, but an additional probably 5 hours or so. And I was like, no, we really don't want to do that. We're gonna drive till we tired. We're gonna be safe. We're gonna have us a parking place. We're gonna do it right tonight. And I was hungry as the day is long. When I got to North Little Rock, stopped for fuel. I didn't have to. It's best that I did. But I had to get me something to eat. And they was cleaning the toaster. There was something wrong with the toaster at the Subway. So I couldn't get my normal toasting on my steak and cheese and sriracha sandwich. So I learned a good lesson last night. I wanted to share that with you. It is not the same if they microwave your steak and cheese sandwich with the sriracha on it. It is not the same as if they toast it. Not only does it not have the same flavor, and I don't like that, but I'll be damned if it's not like chewy, harder to deal with. The steak don't wanna cooperate. Cheese is kind of funky. It's overall a bad experience. Now, for a fat dude that's hungry, it's filling, but, And by the time I done finished that whole footlong and some chips, I was getting tired. And sometime after midnight, about 1 something or other, I guess it was about 1:30, I was getting down here by Prescott, Arkansas, and I was like, every damn truck in America decided to park and sleep in Arkansas last night and early this morning. I thought it was bad in North Little Rock when I was there at the Pilot Flying J, trying to get fueled up and trying to get out of there. Hey David, how you doing? I thought it was bad then, but damn. They was parked all kind of stupid on the highway. Every rest stop was not just full, but it had one or two rows of trucks parked behind people who were parked. I for the life of me, I can't get in my head. I can't wrap my head around. What is your, how is it that you pulling in there and blocking that whole damn thing up? How is that a good idea? There ain't a fire truck invented that can go between trucks that are this far apart. Somebody's truck caught on fire there, it would burn the whole fucking parking lot. You couldn't get, you had to fight the fire from the highway, shoot some water over there, run up in there with about 300 foot of hose or some shit. What the hell? You don't be stupid. That is some stupid ass parking. TA right over here, across the highway, that place is humongous. And it was, I mean, driving in, I was looking in there, I could see a lot of stupid parking in there too. But there was a lot of reserve spots that were open, oddly enough. But across the highway here, this is where you can creatively park day or night. And nobody gives a damn. They might jack with you over to TA, I doubt it. But they might jack with you over there. But over here, creative and stupid parking is an art form. I found this place totally by accident, had never been here before I delivered across the street over there at Firestone. But I found me a new oasis. I used to bust my ass whenever I was trying to get a load up north. I would run out of time coming somewhere around Malvern. I remember these days, I would try to get to that rest stop and get a parking place, and if I couldn't, I had one other opportunity right on the Saline County, Pulaski County line, I think, or the Saline County line on the south side, I don't remember, it's exit 401, yeah, JJ's, whatever, and then a lesser, but still, you know, possible, there's another one of these mom and pop type places up the road just a piece. I can't remember the name of it to save my life. Hey, K5. You know, I didn't really have, I mean, you would have to bust your ass. You'd have to bust your ass to make it there before everybody else did. And they're doing some kind of big time parking lot shit revamping. They took all the pumps out at that place. I want to call it the 45. I don't remember what the name of the place is. I've parked there 1,000 times, but they're laying new concrete. They took all the pumps out. Looks like they put new pumps in. That whole area was closed off. I think they might gonna be paving the hell out of the parking lot here pretty soon. That place is humongous, and you can usually find a place to eke in if you got no other choices. But now that I found this little spot, as long as all you motherfuckers don't show up over here and clog it up, there's always parking over here, man. Like I say, man, it was 1:30 in the middle of the night. All the regular parking spaces were taken, and people were getting creative as hell. I found 3 or 4 creative spots that I could have been in, but I wasn't real comfortable with that. I pulled in back here behind me, and I created a spot. I created a spot right behind me right there. Plenty of room for everybody to move around. It wasn't like, hell, it was probably a spot that just hadn't been taken yet. But I created a spot, and I started a trend. You know, everybody started stacking on me, and then I moved up here. I wanted to get some of this here, the shade right up in here, so I could actually see y'all and shit like that. Uh-oh, somebody done called me. There ain't nothing I love more than getting a debt collected. Kiss my ass, how about that? So I like this little old spot. This is now a new home when I'm coming up 30. If I'm running out of time or if I'm tired, this is my new home, this is my new spot. I'm eventually gonna get in this restaurant right here. It's Norman's 44 restaurant. It's exit 44 off 30. I'm eventually going to get in there. I'm going to try it out. I probably won't step foot inside the the actual truck stop area up there. I probably won't go in there. It looks like crime scene to me. I don't like it. I really don't like it. But the restaurant is right here, right in the middle of the damn parking lot. We might try this out. Give this a shot. Maybe not today. Maybe tomorrow. But my load's not due till 5:30. Got a 5:30 appointment this evening. And it's a more reputable brokerage that we got this load from. It's Dart. The Dart Advantage Logistics. And if Dart set it up, they're more on their game than a lot of brokers. So I'm sitting here, just drew a damn blank. If they set up an appointment for the pick and or the drop, it's probably written in stone. So, plus I'm kind of tired. I got my rest on, and I got up without any alarms or anything like that. And way early. Took my time making the Bubba Cup juice. Took my time making my little Twinkies. Doing a little clean up, doing this, doing that, doing the other. At the end of the day, you know, with extra time like this, it usually bothers me. It bothers me a great deal because I like to keep moving. If the tires ain't turning, you ain't earning. And when you got payments to make on, you know, capital payments like this, capital expenses and shit, it's Robin Hood, man. Probably not tell me about it. Yeah, Tesla is up 10% to $585.78 today. When you got capital payments to make, you know, your mindset can be one of two things. It can be I want to be broke or I want to make money. And you can't make money sitting when you got capital payments. I like to quote a young man that I have a great deal of respect for. He and I do not share the same opinion about leasing trucks. We differ. I mean, we're on different ends of the spectrum where that's concerned, because I've taken such a hit. I just got an email this morning. Money that I owe a company because of that bullshit 2 years ago, year and a half ago, you know. Year and a half, something. I don't know. Year, last year, whatever. When? Oh no, it was 2 years ago. Yeah. Anyway, for having, you know, used trucks that, you know, had all the breakdowns, the constant repairs, and all the bullshit that I had to go through, and the tens of thousands of dollars that were sitting in my account one day, going, then almost literally the next day, I can't even make payments. I mean, it spiraled out of control so fast, so badly. The bills were so fucking high, and I was overextended. I made a mistake. I just didn't want to. I always held out hope. I always had hope that I would find that, you know, I'd pull that rabbit out of my arse and I'd make it happen again, you know. It's okay to be a little bit behind. Shit, we'll get a whole lot ahead later. No big deal. But, you know, I was fooling myself, because that next breakdown on the vehicle, that big truck was coming. It was right around the corner. was always right around the corner. And it stressed me out so much. Because I knew it. I knew it was coming. It stressed me out. So without the bankroll that I had behind me, you know, trying to be fair, trying to be very giving and everything with my drivers, and trying to be the word escapes me, but I wanted, generous, that's the word I'm looking for. Being very generous with my drivers, helping them out every turn, doing whatever I could to make things happen for them. And, hey, Z! And it ended up biting me in the ass, you know? It really did. It bit me in the ass. And it wasn't worth the stress. It wasn't worth what I went through. It wasn't worth the chest pain and the stomach problems and other shit that comes with that kind of thing. You know, it's just not worth it. You know, always knowing that the other shoe is going to drop, waiting for the other shoe to drop, because you know it is. I couldn't do the no matter if you own the truck or not, I couldn't do the used truck thing anymore, man. I just couldn't do it. And there's only two alternatives: buy a new truck, which I had no money to put down. Now I got all my fucking money's gone, or, you know, go to work for somebody else. So I did. You know, I did. I went to work for somebody else, and I worked through the problems. I worked through the problems. I worked through the day in and day out. I bit my tongue. I watched people who have no fucking clue about trucking, you know, try to tell me how trucking is and what trucking is and what trucking does. Eat a bag of dicks. That's what you do. You don't know shit from Shinola. Go eat a bag of dicks. That's what you do. I know what I know. And I just eat by, you know, just on the daily. Just trying to make it. But I watched this young man. Y'all know him as, I guess, Chasing Andrew. He's just funny to me. He's a funny young man, enterprising, entrepreneurial, very, very, very intelligent young man. I like to watch him. He makes me laugh. And I'm watching him. It's like, not that he's one of my children. It's just, if you have a child, you got a really intelligent child, and you're watching them stumble through, or occasionally trip or whatever, but get back up and go at it and succeed. It makes me, the blessings that he has, and I've prayed for him so many times. I see something down the road. I see something about to happen to him. I start praying that he makes it through it before it happens. The reason I bring him up is, you know, he got out here. His reasons were money driven. He was one of them loader people, you know, hand loading shit like at FedEx or something. He got to talking to the truck drivers, and they told him how much money they made. So then he went to truck driving school, and you know, and he drove for a mega carrier or two, and then he decided to get a lease truck and try to do that, but you know, bad things happened to him. That's the stumbling and the falling and stuff I was talking about. I watch all this. I didn't watch it in real time. I haven't watched probably but about 20% of his content. But he's got, his content's so massive, so that's a lot. It really is. But he went through all this, and he developed a hatred in his heart, really. I mean, maybe it's not hatred, but he's got a problem with leasing and lease trucks and lease to own, lease purchase and stuff like that. And there's a lot of people out there that have had really good success with leasing a truck and sticking with it and eventually buying it and stuff like that. Andrew, his name's Justin. Justin was very fortunate. A couple turns in his life, he was very fortunate, very blessed to come across some money-making propositions and stick with it. and he stuck with it. That's the key. You can't make money fast out here. It's not going to happen, not in a truck. He found the opportunity, went to the oil fields, and he busted his ass out in the oil fields, broke down all the damn time in somebody else's bullshit truck, and he did what everybody, all of us, here's your golden nugget for the day, Smooth. He did something that men just don't do. He listened. He asked questions. Golden nugget, man. He listened and he asked questions. He didn't let his ego get in the way. He asked people who knew. Now, Justin would probably be the first one to tell you he don't know a fucking thing about mechanical shit. He's not a mechanic. He's a truck driver. He's a business owner. He's not a mechanic. He'd probably be the first one to tell you that. I feel comfortable saying that. I feel like he would say that. And he would say, you know, that's not his job. All that business ain't his job. That's why there's people out there to get paid to fix shit. Because, you know, truck drivers don't fix their shit anymore, really. I cringe sometimes whenever he's talking about certain parts of a truck or certain things. I cringed on videos and stuff like that. A lot of little bitty tiny problems that I would have fixed on the side of the road, he's just sitting there, you know, waiting on somebody else to come and get him going or something, you know. Somebody stopped and helped out and got him back on the road, but that was the old days. But he ended up, by talking to somebody, he found a truck. He bought it cash. He run that truck. He made more money. Started stacking money because he owned the truck. Before he ever put it on the road, he put it in the shop, make sure everything's right with it. Got out there, busted ass. Had a Mercedes engine just like I had in that Columbia. That's, you know, one of the reasons it endeared me to him just a little bit, because any problem he might have, I might have, you know, with our Mercedes engines, I keep an eye on this here. Because that's me. I keep an eye on everything. He recently put his truck in the shop, recently as in this year, put his truck in the shop to have an overhaul, a rebuild. He calls it cutting the block. These terms that he uses blows me away. You know how they grind a block down, make it nice and smooth and everything, so everything seals just right? They did that with the block. He calls it cutting the block. I guess the people around him call it cutting the block. There was a term, now it escapes me, but basically, you know, they do, they cut the block, they level it off and everything like that, make it nice and smooth, so all the seals seal up really good. He had his block cut, we'll just call it that, and new pistons, I think he put new pistons in, sleeves, ring seals, all that bullshit. He had the bottom of the engine done, he had the top, and it's running now, as we're speaking right now, it's running again, and he did that because he had a little problem, and it was just, you know, let's just fix the engine. So he stopped and he got the company that he's working at. He got a Lisa truck, and then he continued to run out there while he's doing his rebuild. Now that the rebuild's over, he can give that Lisa truck back. But he really, really, really has nothing in his heart for lease trucks, because he had a bad experience. He had an International. I wouldn't have fucking leased an International anyway. But it just goes back to show you that at one time he didn't know. You know, he just didn't know when he was, you know, in a bad dude or anything like that. He just didn't know. You know, that's what the company offered. Well, fuck, that's what he got. Ended up it got fuckered off, and he lost out, and they come and picked up the truck at his house and shit like that. You know, that's an awful thing to go through whenever somebody repos your equipment, you know, especially equipment that you live in like this right here. I can only imagine the devastating feeling that I would feel if it got to the point where I just couldn't do this anymore, man, and I had to clean all this shit out, and knowing that they're going to be coming up the driveway and they're going to pull this away or drive this away and somebody else is going to have her, you know, my heart would go out. It's a god-awful feeling. I've had that feeling, you know. I took the Columbia. I drove it all the way back from, you know, I went all the way up to Oklahoma, got in that truck, drove it all the way back to Texas, hooked it up to my trailer, parked it at a neutral spot, called the guy and told him where it was, and keys, and, you know, where the keys were and everything like that, and told him, you know, he asked me where the Pete was. It's in my front yard. You're going to have to send a record, you know, because ain't nobody going to drive that away. It ain't going to happen. And they sent a record. A record come right up in my yard and drug that fucking thing right out of my front yard. I still got big, deep ruts in my yard where they drug it out of there, because you had to drag it out of there. And, you know, I had feelings for that Pete. I had feelings for that Columbia. They were my trucks. I didn't mind giving back to Titan. I didn't mind giving that T680 back. I never was happy with that truck. And it started having electrical problems that just bugged the shit out of me. But I never really got attached to that stupid, ugly little truck. But those trucks that I made payments on for well over a year, 2 years, you know, I was deep into those trucks, man. Tens of thousands of dollars, man. Especially in repairs. And now it's all gone. And I can imagine a feeling when somebody knocks on your door, like they did with him, you know, and we need the keys to the truck, and they drive away in your shit. I can imagine. Unless you're angry, unless you start to build up some kind of anger or whatever, and you just want that shit going. I'm not taking it to them. You know, if I'm angry, I'm not taking it to them. That's the problem. You got to get past that anger and everything. The anger clouds your judgment. Like the, you know, like my Volvo. I love that truck. I didn't want to give it back. It was just better. I had to make the choice. Either I can be in this lease truck for a dollar a fucking mile and less, or I can go make $2 a mile up with my trucks. Well, you know, fuck that Volvo. I went over there. I made a video about it. I was live giving that son of a bitch back to U.S. Express, man. Just pulled it up on the parking lot, left her there. Ain't never seen her again. Got a $16,000 bill for that, by the way. They want $16,000 from that walk-away lease. That's my ass. That's the best thing I ever did in the truck driving world, giving them back that damn. Man, I had just had $10,000 worth of engine work done to it. All warranty work. I didn't put a dime into that. You know, I had a sending unit that I had to buy. That was my only cash out of pocket on that one. But just put brand new tires. Pretty much all the way around, I just put brand new tires on that truck and shit. And I had to give it back, man. The losses from that year, insurmountable. Insurmountable, it seems like. But at the end of the day, I can't get it back. I can't look back and say, oh my God, what if I lost? You pull yourself up by the bootstraps and you start over. You go after it again. You go get it again. I had to bite my tongue. I had to tuck my tail between my legs, put my ego away, put my pride away, and go to work for somebody else. Fucking Martin and shit like that. I made decent money at Martin. Not on the miles. Did I put in some fucking miles? But I didn't put in miles there like I did with Freezards. Freezards was unreal. Unreal fucking legal mileage. No ELD manipulation, no paper logs. I put in incredible fucking miles and didn't make shit. lot of dead ends. But I put in a lot of miles for Martin, but it was the wait time. The wait time was awesome because it started immediately. That was awesome. That's what made working at Martin worth it. And it was nice, clean, and everything like that. But man, you just had an overlord. You had a babysitter. There was so much technology in a truck and everything like that. All the shit that they just watch you so close. I did not feel comfortable. I'm in a brand new truck, 2021 Cascadia. I mean clean, nice, no problems that I can remember that stick out in my mind. And it was a good feeling being in the new truck. And even though they tried to give me an old 2018 International, I don't know what the fuck they were thinking. But got that new truck, and I'm out there, and I'm tearing it up for them, making them some money, making me a little money. It was a good fit. It really was. It was a good fit for the time, because there's no way I could do that for very long. There's no way I could keep doing it for very long. I started recognizing holes in their fucking program and shit like that. They've been doing it since well before I was born. But I recognize holes. I see problems. I see room for improvement. I see change needed. Yeah. Once I recognize problems like that, the expiration has started. The expiration date is in there. And they push the fucking issue with the medical card. I'm out of 5,000. Gotta go do my own thing. And by the grace of God, God just, he let me just go and go and go until I'd had enough. I really had enough, and I had to do it my way again. Maybe I'm just that guy. It's always got to be my way or the fucking highway or something. I don't know. You just get to a point where you know shit. You know what you're doing. You're damn good at it. You don't need folks that don't know what they're doing or think they know what they're doing or whatever to try to run your life. And I'm not talking about the merits, by the way. I'm not talking about Team Merit. I'm definitely not talking about Susan and Kevin. They take way too good a care of their fucking drivers. To the point of almost, I just love them, man. I just love them. And I could have worked for them for a long time, but I would have put myself in a fucking poorhouse. Because taxes would have come around, man, and I wouldn't have had anything to show for it. I made decent money. But at the end of the day, I've got an expiration date. There's a day when I just can't do this anymore. Physically, I cannot do it anymore. And before that day comes, I want to own what I'm in, so I have a stake in it, and I can actually sell it. I can get out from underneath it, and I can set myself up for retirement and shit like that, because I'm way too fucking old to be doing this forever and not have anything to show for it. And God said, you know what, it's time, here you go. And out of the blue, man, something that I couldn't get on my own, no matter how hard I had been working, something that I just could not get on my own again. Brand new truck, brand new trailer, making payments, making damn good money, out here doing what I love to do. I really do. I love making it happen. I hate driving. That's the only fucking hate that I have in my heart, I guess. Driving, and I hate that, because it just fucking hurts my butt bone, hurts my back, my ass, fucking arms get tired. There's all kinds of little things that I just despise about it. But at the end of the day, man, I can't think of anything else I would rather do. I can't think of anything else that would pay me to do what I do. I just can't make this kind of money any damn where. I'm basically built for this. because I don't mind the solitude. Matter of fact, I like the solitude. I like doing this shit alone, getting it done, shit like that. I like this. This is me. This is what I do, you know? And my kids, they don't want me to be away from home like this here, but when I'm at home, the fuck are we doing there, man? What are we getting done? If I go to McDonald's, I become a manager there, and I come home at night smelling like fucking French fries and shit, and I don't bring in near as much money. They can't have near as much tech and near as many gadgets and all the goodies and shit like that that they're spoiled with. They don't get any of that, you know. And I'm not that kind that likes, you know, having a bill coming up and my paycheck is just gonna cover it. We don't have any extra money for anything. I don't like that. You don't like that. Nobody likes that shit. I like the fact that my bills are paid. At the first of the month, every bill I got is paid. Truck, everything. House, electricity, fucking 6 phones in a hotspot, and all kinds of bullshit that I don't even need. All these fucking payments, everything is paid. I still got a bunch of money in the bank. I got my little test coming up tomorrow. I pay cash for that shit. I don't pay for insurance. I just pay cash. They like that shit. This isn't rocket science. I probably wouldn't survive in the rocket science business. Not because I couldn't outthink them or not because they're smarter than me, because I would beat the shit out of them. I would get tired of stupid people around me, and I would just beat the shit out of them. I'd become frustrated. It's better than I'm sitting in a truck and not out there, you know, fucking people up, you know, touching them up. Because sometimes people need a little touch up. They're stupid. They do stupid shit. And you can't fix stupid. Maybe that's just me. I ain't touched nobody up in a long, long time. Don't want to either. But if I was in rocket science, I'd probably be touching up some of those pocket protector people and just have some stupid ass ideas. No real world experience. These trucks stopped 3 days. That's all it would take. I want to talk to y'all about that whole strike thing and everything like that. 3 days. They had it set up for 4 days. But 3 days, you start feeling it in America. You feel it. You can feel it. Because they start running out of gas right off the bat. Diesel and gas. There are no deliveries. People ain't moving around. Food. 3 days at the supermarket, man, that shit starts getting real thin. You start buying shit that you wouldn't think you would fucking eat. It doesn't take long, man. It doesn't take long. That just-in-time warehousing that stores have now, 3 days, man, you start feeling it big time. Within a week, people want to holler uncle real quick. They like their little lifestyle. They like their little comfort zone that they're in, their complacency and everything like that. And you touch them on a deep level that they can't even imagine. And the trucks, if they stop, no matter what you order online, don't think you can get online and just order it and it's going to show up. Because a truck brought it. A truck brought it to a fulfillment center for Amazon, and a truck carries it away. That shit just stops. Everything stops. So I understand their strike. I understand it was also they said something about it was about the elections or something and some other stuff. I you know, after y'all told me about it, I started digging into all of it and everything like that. It seemed like it was a little bit better organized than it has been in the past. Just got a lot of people talking a lot of shit in the past. But it was a little bit better organized this time. It's canceled. in case anybody was wondering, it's canceled. It's not going to go down. The 26th, 27th, 28th, 29th. That was all during the Thanksgiving thingy, too. They timed it, you know, for the Thanksgiving thingy and the Black Friday thing. That's my feeling. I mean, looking at the calendar, that's what it looked like to me. They canceled it for some reason. But somebody said it was about voting, about the vote, you know, and how things went, and how the elections, not necessarily how the elections turned out, but what happened during the elections. And that's one of their focuses of the protest and shit like that, which I cannot understand how you can. I'm just looking at this from the outside, although I'm on the inside. Okay, you've got two camps. You've got two distinct camps. Half of America feels one way, half of America feels the other. Half of them are happy about the outcomes, and the half of them are not. Doesn't matter how it comes out, it flips back and forth, but half of America. Well, do you think everybody driving a truck is in one camp or the other? No. I don't know how many that are driving a truck or on this camp and that camp, but from my perspective, you're not going to get a total 100% shutdown anyway, regardless. But if you're using that as your excuse for how things went, you're probably only going to get half the trucks, or you're only going to have the availability of half of those trucks to do it. The other half, no, they're happy with the way things turned out. So you're striking for the wrong fucking reason. I mean, right there, you're cutting out probably half of your possible strikers. You can't do that. If you're gonna organize a blue flu or a shutdown or any of these things, you've got to appeal to every single person behind the wheel. You've got to touch them. You've got they have to feel like you do. They have to feel similar or exactly like you do. You've got to you have to have a common cause that everybody is feeling, like fuel in the trucks, you know. That's why the trucker strike in the 70s was so successful, because everybody was suffering from the fuel going up like it did, you know, and you know, truckers couldn't make a fucking living, and you know, they was like, fuck it, we're just parking on the fucking highway. And they were successful. They were organized around a single idea that everybody was suffering from. It made sense. It makes sense. Still to this day, to me, it makes perfect sense. I get it. And you're coming off of an era, you know, your Jimmy Hoffa eras and shit like that, when, you know, organizing and striking and stuff like that was big time. Right now, you're living in the land of snowflakes. You're living in the land of safe spaces. These people aren't hard. These people don't have a fucking spine. Oh, I might get fired. Oh, somebody might not use my truck anymore. Oh, I might lose everything. You're not gonna get these people to strike, man. I don't believe it. I just don't believe it's possible. Because I just don't believe these people have the heart for it. If a country decided America looked pretty good and they wanted to invade us, let's use this as just a rough example. If we were all being threatened by a foreign country coming in, going to invade, okay? Right now, people talk about civil war and stuff like that. Well, these fuckers talk about civil war do not have the heart for it. Trust me, they do not have the heart for it, nor do they have the skill set, They don't know what this means. They have no idea about target acquisition, cover, concealment. They have no fucking clue what they're talking about. They just saber rattling, beating the chest, but they have no fucking clue what they're talking about. But if we were being invaded, you know, everybody's taking up arms, you know, and everybody's defending the country, you know, everybody has the same primary goal: repel the invaders. Do not let them succeed in what they're trying to do. And this is, and I'm going to an extreme to prove a point. Those people would have the heart to at least try, to at least get out there and stand opposed, you know, form a line, and this is, you know, this is mine and you can't have it. To get a bunch of people who have a vested interest, and in my case, $209,040, you try to get people who have a vested interest to stop moving for 4 days, not make any money, not know what's on the other side of it, not know if you're going to even get another load after it's over, and it's not just going to be 4 days you're off, because it's going to start back slowly. And some people have plugs and hookups and shit like that that you don't have. You're, man, I didn't really want to talk about this, but you know, on the back side of these long ass live sessions, I think it's a little bit safer to talk about, because that's not what the whole thing is. I did want to talk about it. Me personally, I'd love to shut it down. Yeah, fuck it. I am a throw a monkey wrench in the fucking system. Shut it down. Let's fix it and then crank it back up and we're good to go. But it's got to be for the right reasons. No matter who I feel should be in the highest office in the land, and the second office right below that, no matter who I personally feel like would do a better job and stuff like that, shutting down the country and having the common person out here suffer for any length of time because you're not getting your choice, you feel like something has occurred that was illegal or immoral or something like that. I get it. But you want me to risk my $209,000 investment here and all the money that I got coming in and my kids' possible hard times? You know, we need to pick something, in my opinion, you got to pick something a little bit different to strike about. You got to pick something else to shut down about this. It just doesn't fit for me. Do I support it? I guess I was asked how I feel about it. Malcolm X, He had a phrase he used: by whatever means necessary. And I do believe in that. You use everything at your disposal when you're right, when you're doing the right thing, when you're right, you're following a moral code, and you're trying to make things happen. You use whatever means necessary to affect that change. I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that to a certain point. Violence is never the answer, but I'm okay with that. You know, and this is this is a really, really big, strong industry that could flex its muscle and get things done. It's got to be for the right reason. It's got to be for the right. I can't get behind something that's only going to enfranchise half the country. I can't do it. And I can't bet my children's futures on something that only half the people really want. I can't do that. That's called adulting. It's called adulting. I'm angry. I'm angry at how this whole election thing happened. Everything. It's ugly. It's not clear, transparent. I guess cheating has been going on since human beings have been around, and you gotta expect it. But I can't stand liars or cheaters. I lump them in right there in there with the child molesters, man. I can't stand them. You ever been lied to? You ever been cheated? Anybody ever stole anything from you? Can't stand a thief. All through school, I was taught that there were checks and balances, and I always believed that no matter what, there was kind of a reset, you know, or a safety switch, not a reset, a safety switch. There's always a safety in there. It was built in 200 and some odd years ago. Very intelligent men, far more intelligent than myself. Far more intelligent and learned than myself, had figured out a way. And over the course of 200 and some odd years, other very intelligent and learned people had tweaked it or whatever. And right now, it's still holding its own. Right now, yeah, I get you, Mark. I get you. I feel it, man. It's like, you know, I don't give a damn who you support. It does not matter to me. I do not care. I don't want things forced down my fucking throat. And I don't know anybody who does. I don't know what anybody who likes, you know, being told, you know, you gotta support this, you gotta do that, and blah, blah, blah. And nobody likes being told that. Nobody likes being pushed and shoved and everything by bullies and stuff like that. Nobody likes those things. In America, I was blessed to be born here. I was totally blessed to be born here. This is the greatest nation on the face of the earth, bar none. This is where the experiment started that took off like wildfire, and other countries emulate. Why does everybody want to come here if it's so damn bad? Because it ain't. It ain't that bad here. It's really, really good here. And everybody wants what this country promises. We have checks and balances. We have a system. It's not perfect, by far. Definitely not perfect, but better than any other. Better than any other. If you don't like it, move. If you don't like it, Canada is just, you know, a couple miles north. Mexico is just a few miles south. Bye. You don't like it? Then get elected and change it, or shut the fuck up, or move. I don't care. I don't care to hear what you got to say, because all you're doing is bitching. United States is not a fucking safe space. United States is definitely, definitely not snowflake land. We don't do that here. Do you have any idea? Let me ask you. Do you have any idea why they give away participation trophies and shit like that? Do you have any idea what's behind that? It's covert as fuck. It's not a conspiracy theory. It's a fact. Yeah, anybody... It's not because they... Holy shit, my dad's calling. This shouldn't take very long. Hang on just a second. I'll get this on video. Hey, old man. Hello? I thought you were dead. Yeah, what are you doing? I've been trying to call your sorry ass. Rock on, baby. Well, I'm glad to hear you're alive. Did you? Oh, you gonna get cremated? Yeah. Oh, the hell with that. Damn it. Well, make sure you have them while you're there doing the new phone. Put my name in with this number for you so you'll know when I'm calling and you'll answer the damn phone. Yeah, I'm always 24/7. I'm always in this truck, so you can always call me. Doesn't matter. Okay. All right. Well, call Jada. Bye-bye. Well, my dad's still alive. That's pretty fucking awesome. Been calling him, can't get a hold of him, but see, he gets so many fucked up calls, you know, warranty people and all that bullshit. He just won't answer the phone anymore. He's older than dirt, man. Jesus Christ. Let's see. We figured this out before on one of these live feeds. Let's see. 37 is it 3? Okay, let's keep that 3 right there. Okay, so that's 40. That's 60, 70, 80, 83. He's 83 years old. Lives on his own. That's a good thing. He finally got his phone working. Awesome. Going back to what we were talking about, do you have any idea why they give away, there was this push for participation trophies and shit like that? Do you have any idea what that was all about? Anybody? No? No, you don't. You don't know. It is, I swear, man, once I say this out loud, you're going to be like, yeah. Have you ever heard the word toxic masculinity? Anybody? This is not a conspiracy theory, so anybody who tries to label it, you're full of shit. And go eat a bag of dicks. Go eat a bag of dicks anyway if you disagree with what I'm saying, because I'm right and I know it, and this is just the way that it is. This is one leg or one part of the emasculation of the American male. Follow me. Feminists and communists and some other folks, they determined that you couldn't take United States on a communist. They're helping out. They really are. You can't beat the USA. You cannot. United States of America, strongest country on the planet, and always will be, as long as there are men like me and you. So they decided we got to take them from the inside. Got to weaken. This is how they take countries. You know, you got to weaken them from inside. They have to melt away, and then you go in and you just take over. That's the only way to win here. And the feminists are maybe knowingly or unknowingly a part of this, but I'd like to think that they don't realize what they're doing. Forgive them, Lord, for they know not what they do. But this toxic masculinity theory, somebody made up, they come up with this, masculinity is not toxic. Masculinity and femininity are biological. They're what we are. I'm male. I'm naturally, because of my big giant fucking balls, masculine. I didn't grow to a humongous fucking size, and I don't work out, and I could probably lose a fight if there's no bricks or bottles or whatever near me. But as far as masculinity is concerned, a lot of folks like to use this this term, toxic masculinity, to combat something instead of hitting it head on. They try to go an end run and pull some kind of stupid bullshit. Follow me. I hadn't really wanted to talk about this right now, but why not? I got plenty of time. Toxic masculinity doesn't exist. Masculinity exists. There are feminists out there that don't like it. There are man haters out there. There's probably just as many female haters out there as there are man haters, and men that do terrible things to women just because they can and do and everything like that. I get that. And there are some females out there, feminists out there, and even some males that believe that men are just a little too fucking big for their britches. They're just, we have a problem, we gotta solve this problem. These men that are just overbearing, ego driven, misogynistic, blah blah blah. So we've got to tone them down a little bit. We gotta bring it down. We gotta bring down that toxic masculinity. It's horrible. We gotta bring this masculinity down to size. That's their thing. See, the thing about males, it's mammals. It's the whole mammal world. We're all pretty aggressive, especially in mating times. We're very aggressive. Okay? Going somewhere with this. Listen, Linda. We're very aggressive. It's the testosterone. It just does it. It's natural. It's biological, and you can't fucking hide it. You can't snowflake it out of us either. It ain't coming out. Houston, we have a problem. So to combat this, they come up with terms like toxic masculinity, and they market this shit. It's unreal how they market this shit. I watch it. I sit back and I watch this stuff going on. I'm like, I wonder if anybody actually believes this shit. Well, they do. There are people out there that believe this stupid shit. Toxic masculinity does not exist. You're full of shit. There are toxic people. They are. There are males that are toxic, but there's no such thing as toxic masculinity. Masculinity is masculinity. Either you are or you aren't. It's kind of like being pregnant in a way. You know, either you're masculine or you're feminine. There's really, I mean, I guess there's some shit in between, but I don't know. Masculine, malish. If you're malish, you're masculine, you're the protector type. There's several different masculine traits, I would think. You're the protector type, you're the hardworking type, you're the high achiever type, you're the fucking crackhead type. I mean, whatever type of masculine person you are, it's inherent. It as long as you got testicles, you're producing, you know, testosterone, and you do things hormonally and otherwise that are there's behaviors that, and they are actually very predictable, by the way. Your character is more important in determining, in my opinion, your character, your faith, your character, and stuff like that is it determines what you do with that aggression and that masculinity and everything like that. Like when somebody pisses you off and you want to put a brick upside their head, if you don't, you're a thinker. You're thinking that out. Your character says it's not legal, it's not moral, it's not a good thing, whatever. That's you know, that's part of that controlling your natural drives and behaviors and stuff like that. That's a good thing. But these feminists, they come up with this plan, okay? And it's not gonna work. It doesn't work because there's still testosterone coming out of the little guy's nads. It's their behavior. You're trying to change determinative behavior and whatnot. Trying to weaken the males by saying, we're not going to make this sports activity, we're not going to make it so aggressive. We're going to make it less aggressive by not having a winner at the end. We're not going to keep score. We're just going to play the game. Everybody's going to have fun. And that is going to make the male less aggressive. That's why they give participation trophies. That's what that is all about. It's trying to make the male less aggressive. That's the truth. And you can argue with me, and you're lying sack of shit, and you can eat a bag of dicks. I ain't listening to you. You're wrong. Fuck you. In your ass. That's why they do it. That's why they do it. I always thought it was stupid. Why play a game if you're not going to have a winner? Why play a game if you're not going to teach little guys and little gals, you know, the feeling of victory and how good it feels to try really hard and succeed, and how bad it feels on the other end of it, how bad it feels when you don't succeed, and you don't want to feel bad like that again, so you'll try harder the next time. Participation trophies are the devil. They should be shoved up the asses of all those motherfuckers who think they're a good idea. Kiss my ass, eat a bag of dicks. There you go. I don't give a fuck about you and what you fucking think. I know why you do it. I know why it was invented. I know why all of that shit became a thing. I hate it that my children have participation trophies in my fucking house. I hate it. With passion. You know why? You have any idea why? Nobody's trying to teach my kids out there in the world. Nobody's trying to teach my kids that it feels so fucking good to win. To try harder the next time if you lose. Try harder. Put more into it. No, you're trying to weaken a fucking nation is what you're trying to do. You may not be trying to do it directly, but you're trying to weaken a whole fucking nation by producing a whole fucking generation of kids, males and females, who don't fucking try. Who don't want to try any harder because they really don't know what it feels like to win or lose. They never have. They're all winners. They all got a trophy because they showed up. Which, great. Teach them that showing up is the first part of it. And teach them how to deal with loss. Teach them how to deal with those feelings inside that, oh, we almost had it. teach them that they can try harder, and next time they may succeed. Probably will. Because now they've got that stinging loss, and they don't want to feel that loss anymore. Don't give them fucking trophies for losing. Give them trophies for winning. Give them something that they can see. A gold trophy and a silver trophy for second, because you tried real fucking hard, but you just, right at the end, you just lost. The other team was a little better. Give them those fucking trophies. I guarantee they try fucking harder. Guarantee. Or they quit. Either way, shows character. Builds character. Not trying to build character by, you know, they go out there and they run around. My son, Travis, he's my favorite, y'all know that. He's out there picking fucking flowers in the outfield. He's bored shitless. That ball ain't never getting out there. He's just out there as a fixture. And he knows it. And he knows at the end of the year they're going to give him a fucking trophy because he showed up. He's not trying very hard. He doesn't fucking care. I, on the other hand, ain't having that shit. And my kids are very competitive. But not with other kids out in the world. Because they know, why try harder with them? You're not proving anything. You're just going to give me a fucking plastic trophy. I got a shitload of them at the house, man. A shitload of them. My kids don't even fucking care about them. They're laying on the floor over here in a closet. They're not all on the mantle. They're all not lined up and shit like that. Got little fucking medals and participation trophies. They're everywhere. Everywhere, all over my fucking house, in boxes. They don't care. My kids don't care about them trophies. They don't give a fuck about them trophies. You know what they give a fuck about? High fucking score. Yes. I didn't even have to teach them that. They got it naturally. It's their toxic masculinity, of course. But they've all got high scores on something. They go to fighting. They'll go to fighting over a fucking game, trying to win, man. My youngest, man, he is a fucking, man, he gets in there and when he's battling his brothers and you see him, you know, there'll be four little fucking squares on the fucking TV, their mama's in there playing with them and shit like that, and they're in it, man, they're fucking in it, because it's natural, and I let them be natural. I'm not going to try to tell my kids, y'all need to tone it down, you're showing signs of toxic masculinity, and we're going to have to correct this. So y'all will have a good character and be good, fine, upstanding snowflakes. Not my kids. I see bumper stickers every once in a while make me laugh, but it's funny. It says, "My kid beat up your honor roll kid." Now that's not something to laugh at. It is, but it's not. The bumper sticker's funny, and what it's saying is really bad. It's really bad. Because, you know, the kids, you know, they shouldn't be beating up the honor roll student. But, because I got honor roll students. But, because I'm proud of all of them. They all do their best. That's what I'm shooting for. With my kids, I'm just shooting for them to do their best, no matter what. Win, they win. They lose, they lose. I am there to teach them how to deal with loss. How to be humble when they win, and how to deal with the loss, and change certain aspects of their behaviors so that they can become winners, so that they can become successful. Not to change themselves, but to improve themselves. That's what they get. That's what those three little boys in my house get. They don't get snowflake treatment. There ain't a safe space in my fucking house. There ain't a safe space on the acre and a half that I make payments on. Ain't nothing safe about it. You go out there in the fucking woods, you get bit by a snake at any given time. They look just like the fucking leaves and all the shit, and you gotta be careful. My kids are careful because they know there's danger out there. Matter of fact, we got a lot of coyotes around the house. And my boys are somewhat afraid of the coyote. And I don't get that, because coyotes, they're not really big on running up and grabbing, you know, 10-year-olds and 12-year-olds and dragging them off in the woods. I guess, I mean, if they were hungry enough, I guess they could, but chances are they want that chihuahua. Because they don't even fuck with my German shepherds, you know? Size-wise, my shepherds are much bigger than the coyotes around there, and probably just as fast, or not faster, and very brutal. My shepherds would kill them in a heartbeat, but they don't get close to the house. And my kids, when they're outside, there's always a shepherd watching them. So I don't really fear that. I don't fear the coyote. I fear the snakes. I do. I fear the boys going into a situation just doop de doop de doo and not thinking. Travis, he went outside trying to get one of his fucking cats out of the backyard because he's an animal lover just like the rest of us, and he stepped on a fucking board with a nail in it, knowing damn well he's not supposed to be back there. He's been warned, he knows he's not supposed to go back there, but he had to do the right thing. He had to save that cat, even though he could have called the cat and the cat would have come in. But don't get me started on that. He had to take action. My kids take action. They don't sit back and watch the world burn. They grab a bucket and start throwing water on the fire. You know what I mean? Participation trophy? Fuck you. Keep it. I'm liable to burn all those motherfuckers, man. Because they stand for the wrong thing, in my opinion. My humble opinion. I think that they are a tool used by nefarious folks to achieve a nefarious objective. And you can kiss my ass, eat a bag of dicks, suck this fucking dick, whatever. I don't give a fuck. Kiss my ass twice, both cheeks. Spread my cheeks and kiss right in the middle. The brown hole. Keep those fucking participation trophies. By being crude and rude like this, I can almost guarantee that this doesn't go viral. It'd probably get censored. I'd probably get me a strike for it or something on here on the gay tube. The snowflake tube. Something I was supposed to do, now I can't remember what it is. Son of a bitch. Oh, I did get my dash cam in. Got it all set. It's not just set up, but it's set. It's running right. It's doing a good job. I ended up plugging it in behind the microwave over there and then running it through the side up underneath the thingy up there and put it up at the top of the windshield right there. Give me a good view coming down, but out of my line of sight, doesn't block anything. Give that a shot. See how that works out. I don't have to worry about that plug. I wasn't going to use that plug anyway, and that plug didn't get used, shit like that. Very happy. Like 35, 40 bucks all day long. If something happens, I'll go get another one just like it. Probably gray instead of black. The way I feel about things isn't the way everybody feels about things, but I'm sure there's actually about 6 or 7 people out there that feel pretty much the same way I do about things. And I just spoke up for those who didn't have a voice for themselves. That's all I did. I just said what was on other people's minds. I said it. Yep, that's right. I said it. That's about it. An hour and a half of this bullshit, me rambling and shit, is enough. Y'all go do what y'all do, man. I love y'all a long time. I'll come see ya when I'm at home, when I get back out on the road or whatever. after the delivery, unless I have to sit at the delivery for a while, I might come back. Alright. Wizzy, later K5. Y'all be good out there. Me love you a long time. I will see you down the road.